teachers. We're going to start presently. I am president of the Payne-Phelan District 5 Planning Council, and we appreciate your attention to this very serious issue. This meeting has been called by the residents at the resident request. All are welcome to be here. We are going to try to give priority to those who are actually residents of the area when we do the actual time to ask questions and so forth. If you have comment cards, there were comment cards at the table, but maybe everyone doesn't have a comment card at this point, but if you do, it's helpful to write down your comment card or comments in advance. If it's a question that doesn't need to be answered tonight, we can have that question passed on to the police or whoever is the appropriate party in terms of providing a response to the question. If it's a question that's important for being answered tonight, we will have a panel of people here who are able to answer those questions. There are going to be many feelings that are present during the process of this meeting. We're going to have to try to be respectful of each other during this process. We will have a process for people to speak as well as to write their questions. We're going to ask that your comments be limited to 1 minute, and that because even then everyone won't be able to speak. So we're going to ask that you limit your comments to 1 minute, and we will have you line up with staff to prepare to speak. Leslie, where will you be when that time comes? I think Leslie will be by the mic out here, so you can look for her, and I will call her for people to come to speak. I should make some introductions of people who are here. City Council members, I notice Dan Bostrom is here. Amy Brenmoan was here. I think I saw Amy in back. Still trying to get in. Kathy Landry, Council President, is here. Am I missing any other council members? We have county commissioners here. Which of our county commissioners are here? Jim McDonough is here. Anyone else? Rafael Ortega is here. Thank you for being here. We have our county attorney, John Toy, on stage. We have some legislators here. I saw Tim Mahoney. Tim, can you wave? Have you seen other legislators, Tim? Senator Fong Her. We have received regrets from a number of our elected officials. Representative Lesh and Senator Marty have sent in their regrets. With that, I think I want to proceed into introducing the mayor. We are extremely fortunate to have the mayor who is present with us this evening. He has demonstrated concern for this issue, and I'd like to turn the time now over to him to speak in terms of making his comments. Mayor Coleman.
Thanks, Al. Thanks, everybody, for coming out tonight. This is an incredibly powerful statement about a community that cares, a community that wants better for our neighborhood here, a community that is just concerned about what is happening on the streets of the east side of the city of St. Paul. We did have an opportunity to just remember the victim of this last week's senseless act of violence, But I also want to remember everyone that has been a victim of violence, particularly this last year. There have been a lot of our children, our brothers, our sisters, of all races, of all ages, that have been victims of crimes. And we need to remember that this isn't about one incident. This is about a series of behavior. This is about acts that we will not tolerate in our community. This is about acts that no community should tolerate. It is really hard when you've invested your life into a community, when you've raised your family in a community, bought a house, gone to school, opened up a business, tended to your yard, gone to church in this community, to see the things that we have seen, particularly over the last couple months, happening in the streets of the East Side. And I can sit here and tell you all day long about how statistically things are better than they have been, but there is no statistic that will comfort you when you have been a victim of a crime, when your loved one has been a victim of a crime, when you have witnessed some of the acts that are occurring in the streets. What you need to know is that we stand together on all this. You have the top leadership of the city of St. Paul here. Not just elected officials that feel like they have to be here, but we have our department heads that are working in conjunction with all other folks in the community to say, what do we need to do differently? What do we need to do better? How do we make sure that these things don't get repeated? How do we make sure that there's not another victim of a senseless beating? How do we make sure that there's not another child laid to rest too early because of gun violence in our streets? When we come together, we can address these issues. They're not easy. But there are a lot of us and a lot of you that have worked for years to strengthen the East Side, to build it up. Whether you've been on the district council, or you've been as part of a church group, whether you've tutored or mentored a child, read to a child, helped somebody along, whether you just shop along the avenues here, all of those things add up to people that are invested in a community. And when people are invested in a community, we can change what's happening out there. You're going to hear a lot from the chief and from the county attorney about some of the strategies that we have employed and deployed over the last couple of weeks. But you need to understand this is not something new. This is not a reaction to what we saw last Friday or on the 4th of July or during the course of the summer. This is a part of a long-term pattern of trying to figure out how we get ahead of the curve on some of these youth that are committing these crimes. Some of these gangbangers that are running around on the street causing trouble and taking innocent people along with them. The chief has worked very hard with his officers using the best techniques he can. But sometimes they're running from one call to another. And it's hard to stay ahead of that curve sometimes. But what gives, I know, the chief strength, what gives me strength is looking at some of the community work and some of the community groups that are out there. The Youth in Transitions program, trying to get kids steered out of gangs and into the right direction, is an incredibly powerful program. Working side by side with our folks in Ramsey County, working in our libraries, working in our Parks and Rec building. It's not a coincidence that we're standing 100 yards or sitting 100 yards away from a new building that's rising up on the East Side as a testament to a city that cares about all of its communities, as a testament to a city that says we are a city of neighborhoods and all of our neighborhoods have to be strong, all of our neighborhoods have to be safe. I can't say it's okay to have it be nice and strong and safe over in Highland Park, but say that doesn't matter because on the East Side things are falling apart. I know what this is like. I lived in Frogtown for 8 years. And I had summers where it was nice and the neighbors got together and you could walk down the street and feel like you were really part of a community. And there were other summers where one family moved onto the block, maybe selling drugs or running kind of wild, and it totally changed how we felt about that community. Totally changed how safe we felt in our own home. I've heard those gunshots at night. I've seen victims lying on the street. I've been a victim of crime. And it does not feel good. And it doesn't want to make you want to invest in that community. We don't have it right, obviously. Last summer, we had a lot of success. We weren't perfect then either, but we didn't see some of the incidents that we had. What we're seeing the last few weeks and the last few months in the city is troubling. It's very concerning, and we know we need to do more. I've worked with the chief and with the county attorney, with our city attorney, to say let's invest more resources immediately on the east side. Let's have more officers patrolling the east side immediately. Let's flood the east side, and let's make sure that this ends. But let's take this moment as a community to unite and to redouble our efforts. Let's not separate. There are a lot of good people in this room that care about this community. We're all races, we're all ages. Some of us are new to the city of St. Paul. Some of us have been here for generations. Our strength is in uniting, not dividing. So tonight, it's our opportunity to hear from you a little bit, and I'm gonna apologize because I'm gonna leave in a little while. I have some other commitments, but I will be here for a while, and I do wanna hear from you. And I wanna just say to you that we, every member of this community, every member of my leadership team, every member of the police department is committed to making the east side and Frogtown and the north end and the west side and every part of the city a great place to live, to raise your family, and to be a part of a community. Look around you. Look at the strength in this room. Let's walk out of this room united and committed to making sure that we fight to make the east side of the city of St. Paul as strong of a neighborhood as any other community in this state. We can do it. Thank you.
Thank you to the mayor for that terrific address. We're going to be spending most of our time, I hope you know, getting questions from you and getting some answers. So we're going to be getting to that shortly. First, though, I want to call up Chief Tom Smith. He's going to provide a very brief overview of the Widstrand case, and he's going to tell us what the community can expect of the police and how we can all be a part of the solution. So, Chief.
Thank you, Ralph. And thank you for everybody being here tonight. This is a testament of why I live in St. Paul, because people care. Now, I'm gonna give you a briefing of what happened in the last couple of incidents, not just Mr. Wigstrom, because there's been troubling incidents with what we call, it's kind of a national trend with flash mobs. But I wanna tell you one thing. Regardless how we look, regardless where we worship, regardless what our race, ethnicity, or anything else in, this is a community issue. This is not about race. I wanna make that clear. I know people will have some questions, and we've got all sorts of experts tonight. Even I brought a bunch of people from the police department that'll be able to answer even more specific questions when you have them. But I wanna let you know that we are working. We did a lot of good things last year on the east side, and we have some really good partnerships that we've continued to do. And you get three or four or five incidents of large groups of, I've heard, I can say, thuggish behavior, and that can ruin everything that we've done. And I'm not gonna have it. I'm gonna tell you that. We are gonna put the resources, you'll hear about that in a second. But we've done a bunch of great things and partnerships. Last year we started a new program. It was called Intel-Led Community Partnership, Community Prosecution, and Community Policing. And guess what? It worked. We had very few incidents like this of large groups of individuals that come together at a moment's notice. We don't know when. Technology is a good thing and a bad thing, where you can get 40 people to show up on a street corner because they use a device like this to tweet or whatever they use and to show up. By the way, I'm asking parents out here, that's one thing that I'm going to ask you, to make sure that you look at the media tools, the social media tools that your children use. If you get one thing from me tonight, it does make a difference, by the way. That's a proactive thing of us working together. So we had a great year last year. We partnered with 180 Degrees on the east side, Dick Gardell's Run. In fact, we have 30 young men that were part of some large groups last year that we came in contact with, partnered with the county attorney, Youth in Transition, Save Our Sons, and they're still in that program this year. So they're not out in the street causing trouble. So I know we can do things that work on the prevention side, but make no doubt about it. I live in St. Paul. I'm the guy they used to call before I was a chief when there were problems like this for the two chiefs that I work for. We will not allow this behavior to happen on the East Side. We've put a lot of resources here on the East Side right now, and none of you, I don't expect any of you, whether you live any part of the city, to have to take on or to put up with this type of behavior, and I understand it. So now let me tell you a little about the two cases. You know, first in July, we had a young 17-year-old African-American male killed by another young 17-year-old African-American male. After we had a fight just blocks from here, of 40 to 60 people that my officers had to go into, we stopped the original assault, arrested a couple people, some of that group came back, and that young man was tragically killed by gunfire. Shouldn't have happened. Now your police department made an arrest right away, and we have that suspect. The suspect's been charged. We work very closely with all our county partners here. Mr. Widstrand, terrible situation. We already have an individual or a group of individuals that are fighting in the street. They came out of a house. There is 40 to 50 people fighting, and he is brutally beaten. I think all of you have read about most of the details in the paper. I'm not going to reiterate that. So there's already a fight in the street, and this individual then is severely beaten. And we all pray for him, his recovery. It's day to day, I'll be honest. He has a great family. We've met with his family. It's tragic. But what's really tragic is this is bigger than a police issue. This is about all of us. I can't stop a group of people from getting on a device like this and showing up all of a sudden in a certain neighborhood. We are going to send a strong message. But we need your help, and we've met with different leaders. Earlier today, I met with the African-American leadership in the city of St. Paul. We have the NAACP president here, Jeff Martin, African-American Leadership Council president, Tyrone Terrell. We have Reverend Devin Miller. We have Robert McLean from our Police Civilian Internal Affairs Review Commission and also from the Urban League and other leaders that are here. Because we all agree, how, no matter how we look, we can't allow this behavior to continue. So here's what we're doing right now, and then I'll sit down. There's a lot more that I could say. I will sit down so that some of the other people can talk. We put 30 police, you have 30 police officers on the East Side right now that don't have to respond to calls, that can respond to this type of behavior right now. If we walk out of here, they're working. I know they're working, and they are a visible presence. That allows your police officers on the East Side to go to the regular calls so that they don't have to run into a situation of 20 or 30 or 40 people. We've documented since June 1st about 6 or 7 of these incidents where they've happened. People just in the middle of the street fighting with each other. Many times the victims don't even want to cooperate with us. My thing is, where are the parents and what the heck is going on? That's the biggest issue. But I can tell you that I've worked in prevention before, and we've made things work. So we want to look at that. But the most serious offenders, we are going to arrest you. And all of us, from the leadership that you have here, from the African-American community to others, we all agree no violence like this should be allowed to happen. And we have to arrest and go after those individuals that are perpetrating these types of crimes, and we will. So you have 30 officers. You have bicycle officers. I was just at First Baptist Church. And you have bicycle officers. People are saying, Chief, we're seeing your bicycle officers on the East Side. Visible presence. We're working with MTC, Chief John Harrington, my good friend, our former chief right here. He is helping us because a lot of this activity has happened around transit and bus stops. I'm just going to be honest with you. Transit and bus stops. So he is working with us very closely right now. We have Ramsey County Probation. We have our mounted patrol officers. What I'm here to say, there's other resources as well. We're working very closely. You'll hear from him next. Our Ramsey County Attorney, John Choi, also with our City Attorney, Sarah Gruing, to make sure that when we have charges, our officers are arresting people, that we're paying real close attention to what's going on right here and that those charges go through. So those are the things that we're doing right now, but it's a longer-term issue. I can't arrest our way out of this problem. I'm not going to tell you that I can. We will arrest people, but there's a bigger issue about why all of a sudden this year these flash mobs have started to show up specifically in an area. I could tell you it's kind of from Earl all the way over to Mississippi and Arcade down to 7th Street. And even though serious crime is down in this area, I can show you the numbers. It doesn't matter. It's all wiped out because of what is happening. We will not put up with it. You shouldn't have to put up with it. I guarantee you. You'll see me here tomorrow night as well. Thank you.
Thank you very much. To have the police chief here, the mayor here, that's really terrific. Next, we have County Attorney John Choi. John is going to talk about the general prosecution process and the hate bias crime statutes. John.
Good evening, everybody. I'm John Choi, and I'm your Ramsey County Attorney. And I wish that none of us were here tonight, because something very tragic, horrific, and horrible has happened on our beloved East Side in our community. And I remember when I first read the details of this horrific act, I was just appalled. And what hurt about it for me so much is the fact that Chief Smith talked a little bit about this, but we had invested so many things. We were, you know, doing a lot of great things, and we had a great summer last year. But this summer, it's just not been working out, and this act that happened, it just ruined all of that. And but with respect to moving forward, as the mayor talked about, I think it's very important. We're all here gathered as a community, and as we walk out of this room tonight, that we are together and that we are going to be a stronger community. Now, with respect to what happened on the East Side, with respect to those prosecutions, we have been presented by the police with 5 cases, and we have charged all of those cases out, 1 adult. There are 4 juveniles. With respect to 3 of those juveniles, I can't talk about the details of that because it's not public information. But I will tell you that from my perspective as the chief prosecutor, we will not tolerate this type of violence, and we will find and we will seek and we will find justice for Ray and his family and his community. So the criminal process is going to play out, and there's people here from my office who are very dedicated to ensuring that we have accountability and we send a very, very strong message. But moving forward, we have this incident and we're going to deal with it in the criminal justice system. But as a community, there are important things that we need to continue. We need to continue working on figuring out ways to stop this type of behavior. And we talked a little bit about the success that we had this past, the last summer. We're going to double our efforts in that particular area. I just had a conversation with St. Paul Youth Services, and the chief talked about this, but I really think one of the reasons why we had success last summer is that we were going out and finding parents whose children were out past curfew. That's what I think the important part of that is, and so we're going to redouble our efforts. St. Paul Youth Services has agreed to continue their work in an additional month, and so we're going to just go out and try to engage parents, and not in a criminal way, but try to, in a way to find out what's going on and try to get them so that we can get some intervention going on. I think that's very, very important, that we don't lose sight of the fact that this is not all about arresting people and prosecuting people. I assure you we will do that, but it's also about, as a community, how we go about solving this problem of young adults, young kids who have nothing to do, who are out on the street corners causing problems. And we also have to send that really strong message, because quite frankly, what had happened to Ray is pure evil, and we need to abate that. So thank you.
The next part of our process is to have you ask your questions. And if you have written your questions down, that would be helpful. You should form a line at the second microphone back there, and Leslie will be taking cards from people and getting people in order to speak. Leslie. I do want to, while we're getting ready to do this, I want to introduce Gene O'Connell. Is Gene here? Gene is the chair of the school board in St. Paul, and I want to be sure that Gene is recognized. Way in back. Okay, thanks, Gene. Are there any other school board members here that I missed? Another one, okay. Oh, Keith Hardy. Thank you, Keith. John Broderick's here? Okay, great. Keith lives in the area up near Maryland on this side of I-35, so we're glad that he's able to be here. We're going to also have a panel of people who are going to be ready to answer questions, and I think maybe we should have the panel introduced. Mr. Paulus, do you want to introduce your team of who's going to be responding to questions?
Am I throwing you off?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Oh, I'm sorry. You want me to do it later?
Yeah, you can.
Okay. They're going to introduce themselves as they respond to questions, I think is the way it's going to work. So why don't we take the first question?
My name is Rick Cobb. I own two properties over on Coach Avenue. I had 30 to 50 kids go into one of my vacant units and have a party. The police came after I started shooing them all out. They congregated outside. The police made no arrest. They did a breaking and entry. I've got pictures of some of the people, but the police did nothing to discourage them from doing this to somebody else. I sure would like to know why.
Sir, my name is Joe Neuberger. I'm the senior commander for the Eastern District, so the officers have responded report to me. I can't answer that question right now, but if you have one of the contact cards, I will get your information and I will find out. They should have. I can't give you a good answer right now, and I would prefer not to try and just, you know, tell you something without any kind of factual basis. So yeah, I saw that you were sitting near the front here. I'll get your name and contact number, and we'll make sure we find out why.
Thank you.
Next question, please.
My name is Linda Konacek, and I just want to bring up a kind of a partly a safety issue, and I see kind of gangs in training coming through this area. I did draw a map, I'll drop off to the chief, and I've tried to let two staff of the police department and one of the heads of park know about this, but no one seems to have any concern about it. There's two brewery buildings on the other side of the police block across that Bruce Vento Trail. There's a smashed up gate where the kids get onto a walkway of pipes over the trail. It's about 30-foot drop. There's no handrails, and I'm concerned they're going to fall and get hurt. And then when they get to the end on the rainy part of the block, at the dead end of Rainy, right up by the police station area, then they have to kind of climb down and get on a real steep thing and come and bail up over the fence to come through Rainy right by the police station. So I'm drawing a map because I would like that fence that's collapsing in different places besides the gate is open. And it does have a cheap piece of chicken wire hooked onto one side of the broken gate, but it's not attached on the other side, and someone could easily pull that chicken wire off. So I just wanted to, it's a safety concern for the people walking on the pipes across the trail that might fall. Thanks.
Thank you for that information. And we do have folks from our Department of Safety of Inspections. We have parks and rec folks here. And so we'll make sure that they get this information. I ride that trail quite a bit, so I know where you're talking about. And I do want to just say, though, I think one of the great things is as the Hams Brewery is being reclaimed for jobs, hopefully we can get all of that site recovered, and so there are no more empty buildings and pipes and places that kids are getting into because people are working there. But we'll work on getting that. Thank you.
Next question.
Hi, my name's Kathy Kiefer, and I live on the east side of Minnehaha. My biggest question is, our officers are doing a great job, but it doesn't seem like they're being backed up by the administration. They're trained to keep people down, but when they do this, they get reprimanded. And I don't think it's fair. They need to have the authority to thump some heads and
kick some butt. Okay, Kathy, thank you for your comments, your concerns. We, as a police administration for the city of St. Paul, by the way, my name's Todd Axtell, I'm the assistant chief. We do take crime very seriously, and we, as you can see by, we have a lot of police officers here tonight in support of our community members, because a lot of us do live in the city and we care a lot about this city. But the way we go about doing our business has to be in a way that's reflective of our community standards, and we can accomplish the task of making our community safe by, when we do have to use force, it has to be reasonable, it has to be necessary, and it always has to be with respect. And we can do that, and we can do that in a way that we still lock the bad guys up. And I can tell you, as a police officer that used to patrol Payne Avenue, I know that we can lock the bad guys up and still do it with respect and within community standards. Thank you.
Just a couple of things, too. I want to be clear. We have more officers now in the city of St. Paul than I think at any point in history. We've added over 38 officers. Not just patrol officers, but we're going to add more sergeants. We have folks that are now, because of some of the investments that the chief is going to make, we're going to be able to free up some officers that are currently sitting behind a desk, and they're going to get out on the street. We're going to add analysts to help analyze some of the data so that we can sense and detect patterns prior to that. But I also want to say, and it's a little bit following up on Assistant Chief Axtell's comments, I've lived in this community all my life. And I think we're blessed to have one of the best police departments of any city in this country. And they do a good job. But one of the reasons why they do a good job is because they do have the respect of the community. And if they lose that respect because they're going around just thumping heads or beating people up for no reason, I will guarantee you the work that they do will become 10 times more difficult. That is not a strategy for success, that's a strategy for failure.
Next question.
I'm Pat Kiefer, I'm Kathy Kiefer's son. Just to reiterate, so in other words, the higher up is not gonna help out the officers out on the street. Is that what you're saying?
No.
Straight up.
You know, I'm not exactly sure where this is coming from, and obviously when you have a large police department that some people might have some different opinion, but I'll tell you this. I've been a cop here for 24 years in the city all my life. I've always supported our police officers, always. Now, we do hold officers accountable. Sometimes officers make mistakes. I expect you folks to hold us accountable for our actions, but very seldom. I can't even think of it. It's such a small number of officers that are disciplined in the police department, so I'm not exactly sure where this is coming from, except to tell you again, as Assistant Chief Axtell said, we are responsive to the needs of the community. We have extra officers over here. We have more officers. We've got a good leadership team on the east side, and we have always supported our officers. So, and they have an avenue also to talk to us and to talk to me. I've been very open. So I just want to let you know you've got a good police department. We do support what they do. I support what they do, and so do their supervisors. But thank you for that comment.
Thank you. That's what I was asking for right there.
Greg Copeland has the next very short question, I'm sure.
Actually, I don't have a question. I have a challenge to the chief. You know, you told us in your remarks that this all kind of started around June 1. I got to tell you, is it on? Okay. I got to tell you, chief, I had a riot that I reported on the first 70-degree day that we had in the Salvation Army parking lot, where Mo Allison was later killed in July. We didn't have a meeting after that. Then the next 70-degree day, we had a riot in front of my home. I live at 612 East Cook Avenue, four houses off of Payne Avenue. The police department, I'll give you lots of credit, the guys showed up, they brought the horses. I think they had the helicopter in the air, they had perhaps the dogs out, they had the street blocked up and the traffic going down my street. You know, my favorite number is 911. I get asked by drug dealers why I always call 911. It happens to be my birthday. But it also happens to be your number. And folks, we have got to do a better job. And frankly, there's one other point I'd like to make, is that we need a longer-term strategy. You know, we need a strategy with our children.
We need to do some intervention and prevention work with our children. We need our school board to be engaged in doing something that is proactive, that is preventing people from joining gangs and not allowing this to continue.
Let's let the chief respond.
Well, Mr. Copeland, thank you for telling us that. And you know what? I mentioned those incidents, so you're absolutely right. And we have seen an increase this year. And that's why we're putting more resources here. That's also why there are some things that have been going on we'll talk about later in the summer as well, as we continue to go on, that hopefully will make the East Side a safer place. We are continually looking at other strategies. Senior Commander Neuberger and his staff are doing a good job. You know, when the police show up, I just want to tell people here, when you show up usually, and I've seen videos, because we have in-car camera videos for our officers, to 30 or 40 people, as soon as the cops show up, a lot of them run. A lot of them run. They take off. They're everywhere in the neighborhood. I don't have 30 officers that can beat feet and catch everybody. Some of them haven't done anything. Some of them have. Some of them have actually stopped and challenged your officers. And that is not a good thing. And we need to arrest those people, and we have been arresting those people. But I agree with you that we have seen things that have happened this year. The incidents you talked about, I spoke about earlier, absolutely that are going on. And that's why we are looking. I agree with long-term strategies. This is more than just about the police department. There need to be other strategies, whether it's with our schools and parks and rec. We're working with all our partners, and I just want to make that very clear. Thank you.
Greg, let's live. Greg, please allow. No, Greg. No.
Nobody was running away.
Hi, my name is Diane Gill, and I stay at 594 Case. And I want to say that the kids over there, when I wake up in the morning, they're there in front of my house, and they're on my porch. When I go to sleep at night, they're on my porch. And the police, they arrest them, so they say. But when they let them go and take them around the corner, they come back around. I call the police like the sergeant tell me, and all they do is take them around the corner, take their dope or whatever. When they're gambling, they take them, give them a ticket, let them go. So what's the purpose of that?
Yeah.
Ma'am, there's a couple of things that we can do to help you immediately. We'll have our crime prevention person come out to your house tomorrow. If we can get you to sign some paperwork that authorizes us to arrest without your being there for trespassing, we'll get that up, because we've been making those cases. The Chief Axel and Chief Smith both talked about it. There are some restraints that we have to follow. I mean, there's rules that we have to abide by, just like everybody else, as far as prosecution. So we'll increase the efforts. We'll do the best we can. But again, some crimes, we have to follow a process.
Okay, the officer told my son that we already have a no trespassing for anybody that does live there. And they said if they catch anybody there that does not live there, they're going to charge him with that. How is that going to, you know, go take effect of that? How can they charge him for that when he does not, you know, be held accountable for people that's standing out there that does not live there?
If I understand your question, the officers believe that your son is inviting him over?
Yeah, but how can he control people on the sidewalk when they're dressed 24/7? He can't control people that just come stand in front of the building or walking up and down the street. Those people are there 24/7.
Well, you're correct with that point. They can't arrest your son for trespassing on his own house. Okay? That you just can't do that. Well, I'm telling you, they can't do that. And we'll step up the efforts. We've been working that whole case area from Payne west, and we'll make sure that we pay special attention to your house.
All right, thank you.
Next question.
My name is Dale Crock, and my grandson in the second row up there was shocked when he and his friends went to the fireworks, and they were coming home, and there was 20 to 30 of them. In the process of that, Jesse ended up going to the hospital, and he was petrified. I could see his stomach heaving when I got to the hospital. But worse than that, my daughter was riding with me, and the police officers that answered the phone when we were trying to find out anything were rude to her.
and they had the same attitude that some of those gang members had.
Yep.
Worse than that, there should be something in the newspaper that says what the police are allowed to say and not allowed to say, because we could not get any information. And I have one further thing to add, and Leslie behind me is going to talk about the same thing. So far, after 3 phone calls to the mayor's office, I have not yet received a call back. Just about the same response that we got from the police department. The police department have not contacted us yet, the investigation unit.
First of all, I'd like to say that I'm really sorry that your grandson Jesse's been a victim of a crime. But we do have a process in place. First of all, when you call 911, those are not, just so everybody knows, those are not police officers answering the call. That call goes to Ramsey County Dispatch Center, and they're civilian employees. So that's a point that we will certainly document on your case. We'll take a look at that, and we'll make sure we communicate with the Ramsey County Communication Center. As far as follow-up goes, we do have our investigative units here tonight. We'll make sure that that is followed up on immediately. I'm sure that our investigators are working out. We have Assistant Chief Martinez back here today. I know that he is listening loud and clear as well. So again, I'm sorry that happened. We will follow up on that for sure.
All right, I think we should move to the next questioner. We're going to have to move a little faster here. We've used up about half of our question time, and we have a long, long line of people who want to ask their questions. So be very concise in terms of putting your question before us.
We've got time, Al.
My name is Leslie Moore. I live about 5 blocks from here. I was a victim of a crime. Actually, my family was a victim of a crime. We were beat, dragged across the street. This happened in May, the beginning of May. Where's my justice? Nobody made a big deal about it. I get the police report and it makes me look like I'm a criminal. I have not committed a crime. I've lived in this neighborhood for 18 years. I've vested myself in this neighborhood. I work in this neighborhood. I wanna know what the police are gonna do to make me trust you so that you, if I need help, you're gonna show up to my defense and make sure that I don't get killed.
Yep. Ma'am, I hope that, and we've got a lot of people here tonight, that we will be able to get the incident that happened to you so we can absolutely follow up on. I want to tell people something here. For the most part, some people are happy with our service from time to time. We're a big city, big department. But I will tell you this, if you get a hold of the right person, I want to tell everybody this here, if you're not happy with the service you get from the person you talk to, then you call back and you talk to one of my command staff. And I guarantee you that someone will call you back. I guarantee you that someone will take action, but you have to call the right person. Now, we got into before, ma'am, you called and you called the Emergency Communication Center and you said that people were rude to you. But if you have investigative questions, we're going to take a look. That those calls have to come to the right person in the police department.
As a citizen, we don't know who to call.
That's right.
We call 911 for help, not for directory service.
Right, a 911 center should be able to tell you that. But I want other people to be able to speak. But we want to get both of your information so that we can see where your cases are and what has gone on here so that we can help you.
I think some of you have had individual issues that the staff aren't going to be able to respond to, but I think they do want the information so that they can follow up. So if you can put the information on a card about a case that we can't respond to now, they'll agree to get back to you.
I have a request of the chief. Is it possible that someone in uniform could take folks' information? We do have cards, but if there was some place where people could just get the information tonight rather than have to make a call tomorrow.
Can I just say we have Jesse's information. I talked to him before the meeting and I also talked to his grandmother on the phone, so they should be good.
you know, Al, this was just for expediting things?
Where do people go tonight?
Who can record people's concerns?
We'll have officers, myself included, outside the area, and we'll stay till the last person gets their information passed on to us, and I guarantee you, you will get some kind of response from us.
Thank you.
Next question.
Hi, my name is Steve Schoes. I'm a 15-year resident of the East Side. My wife is a 40-year resident of the East Side. We've seen a trend of non-response to calls in our neighborhood, and I feel like if it's on Payne Avenue, then they'll come, but if it's on Edgerton, where we live, north of Maryland, maybe they'll show up in 45 minutes, maybe they won't. We've had cars get rear-ended, we've had fights going on outside of our house at 1 o'clock in the morning, multiple calls from our neighbors as well as myself and my wife, nobody comes. No police come at all. So I respect that you have a lot of police officers and you have a lot of things that you need to take care of, but you know, part of this trend is if kids don't see any sort of police response to anything that they do, unless they're on Payne Avenue in front of the Salvation Army, then they're going to get more aggressive and do more of these things. Thank you.
Thank you. There's two things immediately that I would ask you to do is when you call, you can tell the call taker you want to see the officer. They will respond and they will come see you. If you don't get a response for some reason, you call back and you ask to talk to one of my supervisors. All right? Now, the other piece of that is, and the chief alluded to it, Ramsey County Dispatch handles the triaging of calls. And I'm not trying to push off on another agency, but there is a hierarchy of priority of calls, and it goes into a pending queue, and they're dispatched in the order of priority, and then the next order of receipt. So if it's a crime in progress, accident with injuries, it goes to the top of the pile, and if it's a property damage accident, it could well sit up to 30 minutes. So there are some administrative issues because we've only got so many folks to handle so many calls at a time. But with regards to the first part of it, you should see somebody, and if you want to see them, they will be there, and if not, if you talk to me when we get outside, I'll give you my cell phone number.
Next question.
Hi, my name is Jean. I live on Lawson and Arcade. I'm a 40-year resident and multi-generational in the Twin Cities. My son had a gun stuck in his face during a robbery of T-Mobile at Seeger Square. My neighbor had four tires removed off of his truck while it was parked in the alley. My car was just robbed. Where are you? You say that you're here, you're not. What about holding the storefronts responsible that let these kids congregate? What are you doing about making the parents responsible for letting their children roam the streets? What about our children that don't feel safe in their own neighborhood? What are you going to do about those parents that let these kids run the streets? I'm a responsible parent. Why aren't they?
Gene, thanks for your comments. As far as the parenting issue goes, we do work as much as possible with our non-governmental agencies to partner with youth initiatives. We have several across the city, including programs like the YWCA Junior Police Academy. We try to get kids involved in after-school activities. We also understand that we really can't do it alone. It is a community effort. We need those calls to keep coming into the police department. We all have to take ownership in this community because with 600 officers, we simply can't solve it on our own. So we're asking for your help. We're asking for your partnership. I see the passion. I feel the passion. And we do hear you loud and clear. Thank you.
You didn't answer my question. You just made a statement. You didn't answer my question at all. What are you doing with the parents?
That's the police
See, that's why we came, for answers. You gave a statement. You didn't answer squat.
My name is Danette Alrich. I live.
Al, or could you ask people to maybe quieten it down so people can be heard?
Yeah, Danette has the next question. Danette is active in the Westminster Case Block Club, and I appreciate her asking the next question.
Yeah, you haven't heard it. No, I live on Case. I live in the Lower East Side of St. Paul. I've lived there 13 years. I love my neighborhood. I think it's awesome. I love everything about the East Side except the crime. I have a childcare business in my home, so I have a double effort to keep things safe and record and call on everything. And my thing is, I have to drive up Case, say we go to the YMCA, and there is a section, and you guys referred to it, but between Payne and Edgerton on Case, past the Wilder Park, there is, Diane was just talking about it, the woman who said these people camp out on her her porch. I took the number down on the way here, 594 and 588 Case. She lives at 594. These aren't drug dealers in her porch. They're just people that are loitering. I've reported it. I put it on the Facebook, Eastside Facebook page. I have called District 5. I've called the police. The at 588, and I'm sorry if anybody lives there, but it's a drug house, and it's like constant. I don't understand how somebody can rent a home. You buy a home, invest. Where are the landlords? Why aren't they being held responsible? Yeah.
I appreciate it, but I do want to say, because other people may not know some of the things that we're doing, particularly to go after problem properties and problem landlords. We do have our folks from inspections here. Several years ago, under the leadership of Councilmember Bostrom and Councilmember Lantry, we went to a registration system so that...
I'm in her section.
Yeah, she wasn't on the council yet, but I know she's... Amy Brenmoan is...
She's awesome. We love her.
We all love Amy. But again, I just want to say that we're really going after. We're trying to step it up. It's one of the things that we're doing is trying to get out and inspect more of these properties to go after where there's violations, to remove the certificate of occupancy when we can do that. If there's and it's not just active drug dealing, but really going after unsightly conditions. There are a lot of places that we need to step up our efforts. But I think it's one of those, you know, the old broken windows theory, which is you go after places that that aren't being cared for, because if they're not being cared for, a lot of bad things that can come after that. But that is, your participation in the block clubs, a lot of people have come up to you in the last couple of weeks and said, you know, what can we do? I hope that you're engaged in block clubs. I hope that you're getting to know your neighbors. I hope that you're getting to let us know and be proactive on that. And we're going to continue to work on it. You have a lot of folks in the city. But I wanted to say, and this is kind of where we need to step it up, because of the challenges that we're seeing right now on the East Side, is that I want every one of our department directors to put in, you know, to really work extremely hard to go after these properties right now, where we're seeing these problems come from. I truly believe that this is a small handful of folks that are causing the biggest problems, and if we can get them, get the landlords that are allowing it, get the families that aren't watching out for their children, as was mentioned earlier, you know, we need to let people know. You can either take the highway and you know, go to school and do what you're supposed to do and learn and behave, or you're going to go to jail. And as a parent, you're gonna, we do have, you know, we can't. There's not a crime for a parent if your child is misbehaving. But the fact of the matter is, yeah. We have a couple of our legislators here, but the fact of the matter is, we are working very hard, and we're gonna step up those efforts.
Could I have the DSI staff raise their hands so that we know who to go to? Okay, great. so that if you have questions about that kind of an issue, please check in with them. We do, again, I would say, have limited time. I would ask people to please focus on the specific incidents that we have staff here to address. So please try to frame your questions in terms of the specific incidents, and then we will we can still answer other questions individually later, but let's use the expertise that's here. Christian, you're next.
Thank you very much, Al. Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Chris Schweitzer. I'm a resident of Eastside, and I'm also a member of the Payne Family Planning Council. And I have a question for everybody up there on the dais, and that is, the worst of these incidents, if I'm to believe what I read in the newspaper, are surrounding some hangers-on, these young kids that are hanging around with an actual criminal gang. And I want to know why that gang is being allowed to run around Payne and Case for months and months. You should know who they are. I want to know, why aren't they being tracked? Why aren't they being arrested? Why aren't they being prosecuted? I understand you got limits, but we are uncomfortable on that street, and these knuckleheads in that criminal gang who are inspiring these other kids to misbehave in our neighborhood, they need to be tracked, and I want to know what you're going to do to break that gang up.
That's a great question, and I want to tell you one thing for sure, and I know that we have some of our gang unit here tonight, including our gang unit commander. We have arrested a lot of those individuals already, and there are more people to be arrested. I don't disagree with you, sir, that people that are mentoring people into bad behavior need to be taken off the street. Number one, we do have to have charges so that we can make them stick and work with our county attorney or city attorney so we can arrest them. I can have my gang unit commander come up here and tell you the number of people that we have arrested. Many times they're replaced by someone else very quickly. It's a larger issue, but we are continuing with our gang unit to make arrests and arrests specifically here on the east side, and we will continue to do that. But again, these gangs, these flash mobs are very mobile. So they don't all live on the east side. Some of them we've even worked with Minneapolis, and we usually don't have a lot of interaction between our different groups. Our cities have different challenges, but we know that some of our group is going back and forth with Minneapolis people. We're aware of that. Our gang unit's tracking it. We have made arrests, and we will continue to do so, and I think you will see even more very shortly.
Next. Good to see you again.
Hello. My name is Ryan Grimm, Eastside resident, Payne Phelan area. There's not anybody on the dais who can answer my questions, and I'm a little upset about that because it's about the schools. I want to know what the schools are going to be doing. I want to know what the schools are going to be doing. What the schools are going to be doing to make our kids safer and helping them. I mean, making that transit back and forth to schools. I mean, and I'm surprised that nobody from the school board is up there.
The chair of the school board is Jean. Are you still here? If Jean wants to respond, we'd be happy to hear a comment from the chair of the school board, Jean O'Connell.
We know that parents are concerned about safety and getting to and from school. This year, rather than put money in the bank, as we go to closer to home schools, we've gone to transporting kids who live more than a half a mile from home rather than a mile, knowing that there are safety concerns. And I think that we are open to all kinds of ideas, and if community members want to help us in helping kids walk to school, we are more than interested in making sure that those things happen. We have safety officers in our buildings. We have one of our principals here, but we are very concerned about safety, just as all of you are.
Thank you, Jean, and thank you, Mr. Bradrick, for coming up. I think we'll go to the next questioner now. And let's try to keep them focused on these specific incidents. Sorry.
Sure, my name is Mary Beth Redmond, and I moved in on to Payne Avenue just 6 years ago. I have just a couple things. First of all, I raised five kids as a poor single mom in St. Paul. It can be done. One of my son is an officer, and I'm quite proud that he's a St. Paul officer because there are good people to mentor him, and we don't want our police officers having to behave like animals towards anyone. We wouldn't want them treating human beings like animals, and so I'm very proud that he has the people he has to work with. Two, I have worked in the St. Paul schools for 20 years, Central High School. I have to say, your schools, your principals, your teachers are your partners. But there is only so much they can do when so many of these issues come from parents. So again, I would say, perhaps there's not laws about parents, but we have all the youth intervention services. What about parent intervention services? Where are those resources for parents? And third, just one more thing. This is a good one. There are wonderful work being done. The Neighborhood Stabilization Program. I'm looking to sell my house on Payne Avenue. Every day for the past 2 weeks, we read about the terrible thing that happened on Payne Avenue. Very difficult to sell your house. I'm not selling my house to move out of the neighborhood. I'm selling my house to hopefully move into one of the neighborhood stabilization houses that are in this neighborhood. Wait a minute. The Star Tribune reported on the neighborhood stabilization program. Where is our media? Where is St. Paul Pioneer Press talking about the good things happening on the east side? I can tell everybody I see how good it is to live on the east side, and they all laugh at me.
Next question.
Yes, my name is Greg Murphy. I live on Dale Street North. I have a really bad continuing problem with a rental property next to me. And here's the kicker. It's owned by a Ramsey County deputy. He lets his 23-year-old son screen the people in there. And this is not minorities. These are white kids from 18 to 25. I've been threatened with bodily harm the last 2 weeks. I've had garbage thrown at me and hit me. And I don't get to sleep until 2:30. I'm working with Amy Brendamont, thank you very much. Code enforcement, you're gonna be hearing from me. It's Greg Murphy. I'm on the 1100 block of Dale Street. One of the officers that responded this week, thank God, when you make a complaint, I've had people threaten me to come over, and that happened last week. And one of the gentlemen, the St. Paul police officer with the white shirt on and striped tie, came, talked to her. I'd like to see something done here. This is absolutely ridiculous. As a veteran, I've had it with this. And it's time maybe to get out of this town.
No, but do that.
Thank you.
Next question.
Hi, I have a comment. I've lived on the east side my whole life, born and raised here. The problem is that since like July 4th, there's a house that's been targeted across the street from me that's been shot at 3 times. The recent was Monday evening. My daughter and myself were out in the front. The kids came up the street, they were looking for this certain car, and they shoot at them, right in front of us. Wouldn't even maybe from here to you. And it's like they're blatant. They don't care. It's like they come by, they're looking for them daily. I haven't seen them since Monday, though, but I want to catch them. Mm-hmm. I want to catch them, because that's ridiculous. And it's pissing me off. Serious.
And you should be ticked off. I was politically pissed, right? I guess I can say that here. Man, thank you. I want to tell something to everybody that's here tonight, please. You've got people that are here and our police officers. If you have a problem property next to you, because a lot of what we're talking about tonight has to do with properties, it has to do with some other social issues, but if you have properties, we want to hear about it. And please, and I guarantee you somebody will respond to your problem property complaints. And to our earlier question, and I didn't have even some of the numbers, but one of my gang unit sergeants came up here and said, with some of the recent incidents on Payne Avenue, that even at Payne and Case, at Payne and Geranium, they've used Facebook. Some of these young people are actually posting very graphic things on YouTube where they're assaulting each other. And we have taken that through our gang unit because they are I'm working them to death. And they have taken that information and actually received charges of riot from the Ramsey County Attorney's Office because they've been able to call through and have to look at that social media. That's very time consuming, and we have to find it first. That's why I'm asking for other people to help us with that too. When you come across that, to contact somebody, the St. Paul Police Department Gang Unit, and we have those people that are all here this evening. So six people were just charged in that case in July because of we being able to pull up what they posted on Facebook. So I want people to know that.
We announced that we wanted to prioritize the local voices of people in District 5. So if you don't live in District 5, you live in St. Paul, you live elsewhere, we'll let you speak, but we really need to hear from the residents. That's what this meeting's for.
Thank you very much. My name is Tim Holden, and I'm running for St. Paul Mayor.
No,
I want to just say something real quick. The reality is, Chief Tom Smith. Tom Smith.
No.
One reason. No. Our parents, I think, need to be...
Tim, I think people are asking you to respect.
We're asking, I want to say, I'm going to start from Ray, the gentleman that was assaulted. This is a tragedy. The gentleman that was assaulted, nobody's been saying anything about him. I feel tragic for the guy who was assaulted. I also feel that, you know what, the police need to hold the parents accountable. We need to hold the parents accountable.
All right, Jim, that's enough time. Ms. Hogan, we'll go to the next speaker.
I'm a resident.
All right, let's give the next questioner our attention.
We all hush down, please. I got something to say. That's the question. All right, I live on 713 Magnolia. I'm originally from Brooklyn Park, moved in with my wife. We've been here for 2 years. In the 2 years, my car's been broken into 3 times. Subwoofer was taken once, so I quit playing my music loud. It broke into my car again. Recently, they've been running up on my roof between me and my neighbor's house to the point where there's an indentation on my roof. Now, I'm gonna tell you this. I don't expect the cops to do no more than what they're doing because it takes me 30 minutes to get a response anyhow. I'm a registered gun owner. Now, I ain't trying to shoot or kill nobody. Yeah. But I gotta say, it ain't all about violence. Yes, the parents need to be charged for stuff that they're doing, but people gotta take care of their own. You can't depend on nobody else to take care of your kid but you. It takes a village to raise a child, but if the parents don't individually take care of this kid, we'll be back here next year talking about the same thing.
Hi, my name is Harriet. I'm a new resident. I just moved in. I'm on Arcade and by Arcade, Maryland. I'm going to be honest. When I was looking for houses, I didn't look on these sites. I'm from Detroit. I didn't want trouble. But I found this group. And I've been held up 3 times, beaten. It's all happened to me. But what I want to say is this. I'm a teacher, and I've been a social worker. And this is really what I think. And please don't shoot anybody's kid. I walk into classrooms. I could tell you. I walk right in a classroom and I know who's going to be in trouble. I've worked with kids that long. But here's something I saw on my own little street, my one little block. There's a family there. The father is not mentally capable of raising a child. He isn't. He's not a bad person. He's just not capable. And the mom's not really altogether. So I've seen people in the neighborhood, people are helping the kids. It's a community. We're helping. We talk to the kids. These are kids that are going to be in gangs. That's okay. So let's just be a community, volunteer, and work with the little ones. Let's get to them before they get into a gang.
Let's try to keep our questions focused on the panel of experts that we have here and the response to the incidents involved. Next questioner, please.
I have the microphone. My name is Joseph Baltruconis. I do a lot of volunteering here on the east side. It's very apparent that we have a crime problem here and perhaps a very serious gang problem. We have a rec center. A miracle center that's going up at Payne and Maryland. But how many rec centers did we have to close in order to get this one rec center? We can spend $10 million on polar bears. We can spend $10 million on gorillas and apes. We can spend millions of dollars on a Como pool. We can spend millions of dollars to remove contaminated soil from a second-rate ballpark that's going up. And how many millions just to build that ballpark? My point is...
Did you have a question for the panel?
Yes. Why is the East Side a budgetary constraint and not a budgetary priority? I asked for a few hours for a rec center, and they told me budgetary constraints. I have another point, too.
Let me just speak to that, because there are a lot of folks in this room that have worked many, many years to get investments on the East Side. We saw it with the Phelan Boulevard, and we've seen as a result of that, we've seen new housing going in. We've seen Kendall's Hardware Store, that is one of the best new businesses in town. We see Ward 6, which is one of the best restaurants in the Twin Cities. We've seen, as a result of the Phelan Boulevard, we've seen jobs coming in on the East Side at Health Partners. We've got the new jobs coming into Ham's Brewery. We've got a lot of investment. And I don't think there's any better example of the investment than the building that is going up. Because people have said they we need an immediate response to the challenges that we're seeing, and you're getting it. More officers, more enforcement, sweeps, working with probation, tougher charging, all of those things. But all of us know that the long-term solution, as the woman that was a social worker had stated, working with these kids from the early stages, getting them into buildings where they can learn how to read, getting them into buildings where they can form relationships with trusting adults, getting them into buildings where they can get a bite to eat after school, and they can see that there's a different path. And that's the kind of investment, $14 million worth of investment on the East Side on that block alone, in conjunction with great partnerships, including the members of this church, including a lot of community groups and the district council and all kinds of folks. This man to my right has spent a long time living on the East Side, and I'm going to tell you how long Councilmember Bostrom has been on the East Side, because he gets sensitive about that. But we used to have a saying when he was president of the council: we can't adjourn until we've given $1 million to the East Side. But the fact of the matter is, we're continuing to invest, but we're investing smarter. We don't want just buildings that are sitting there empty. We want buildings that are filled with life and filled with resources for our children and have the best tools available. That's what we're doing across the street, and that's what we're doing across the East Side.
Next question. And keep the questions focused again on the incidents we're trying to address.
Hello, my name's Sina. As you all know, I am the parent of one of the kids that is being charged. And I would like to respond to the comment that the police chief did make. You said, where the heck are the parents? The parents do be at work, which that's where I was when this did take place. I was at work. When I leave my house, my kids are at home. When I'm at work, if my son leaves the house, I don't have no control of that. And at the same time, I've also been a victim of crime in St. Paul, Poland, where a person came into my house, took my kids from their bedrooms, locked them in one room, put my mom in another room, locked them in a room. Police came, found the man in my house, all my stuff in his car, and this man was still released. So yeah, I had a few occasions with St. Paul police. Yeah, they're really rude. Oh my God, I don't even want to know where to start, but we sitting here judging. Y'all say to have respect. They cut sitting here calling these kids hoodlums and all this stuff. Okay, some kids do fall victim to the wrong. Like I say, it's older people out here. In these cases, like a lot of adults that's involved with this stuff that's luring these younger kids. And then they're luring these younger kids. Like I said, my prayers go out to the family. I feel very sorry. If my son did have something to do with this, he will be responsible for his actions, yes.
We appreciate your being here. Thank you for your presence.
Hi, I'm Scott. Been born and raised in St. Paul. Just bought a house in St. Paul in 33. I feel like
the media is 97% responsible for this thing here. I feel like the media is 97% responsible for this. I have heard for 1 month at least about the two Minneapolis white cops that were racist. A direct hit, white and racist, and they were being racist, this, that, and the other, every single day for 1 month now. And all of a sudden, things like this are happening. These kids are getting drunk, getting programmed to hate the white man. And some innocent guy walking through the East Side didn't know about this hood. He shouldn't even be here, really, but he was. And I feel like the little kids, that the little gangster guys that did it, have been programmed for some reason, maybe to take our guns away from the American people. That is... And the media...
Thank you for your comment. We appreciate your comment. Next questioner.
Hi, my name is Darnell. I'm also a friend of Tina. But my question is this. You guys say it's the law, the curfew. What are you guys doing to enforce the curfew? Yeah.
You know, since May 1st, we've had over 100 people on the East Side, young people, that have been picked up for curfew. In fact, that was a program that John Choi and I embarked on last year with our officers that worked so well. But 100 this year so far, then they go to the Youth Service Bureau. There are a lot of other things we talked about before, social issues. Actually, last year, we actually, through this program, the young people picked up, we had somebody come and deal with their parents to address just what you said and the woman before. We decided to try something different because a lot of the parents were working, didn't know what their children were involved with, didn't know their children might be involved or being recruited into a gang. We had great success. We want to mirror that, but this year the criminal activity is trumping. In other words, a very violent activity has trumped what we've been able to do in that area. But 100 citations since May 1st, 100 young people have been picked up in the Eastern District for curfew violations. And we ask you all, if you see people, again, there's 30 kids, I don't have 30 cops to run after all of them. I'll tell you, an event just happened 2 weeks ago, there were 30 girls, absolutely, that were there. They walked right by, in fact, ran by the Eastern District Police Station, and we were able to detain 7 to 9 of them, and that was it. The rest of them were gone.
Next questioner. Again, try to focus on the issues before us.
Hi, my name's Laura Thompson, and I hear a lot of people talking about their kids, your kids. You know, these are our kids, all of our kids. They ask them where the parents are. I mean, we live in a country that incarcerates 25% of the incarcerated population in the world. So some of those parents, they're just not around. And then you got single parents that are doing the best they can. Some of them maybe working 2 or 3 jobs. They're not home at night because they're working restaurants or they're working healthcare. You know, it takes a community. So I suggest, instead of all this finger pointing, maybe people start thinking about, hey, what can I do? How can I get involved with my church, with my community, with my school, and start asking these guys what they're doing aside from just arresting people. What are you doing long term to grow flowers instead of weeds?
Next question.
Hi, I'm Abraham Morrow from, I live off of Brainerd. And, well, last year I had an incident with a police officer that came to my house. And I was asking my kid to do the dishes, and he didn't want to, and he just talked back to me. And the officer ended up coming and arresting me and throwing me down to the ground and put me in jail. And he broke my whole family up. So I, you know, now I'm trying to sell my house and trying to sell everything, but nothing happened to that officer. And they didn't do the right thing. He didn't come and talk to me, he just threw me in jail. So that broke my family up. So now you're gonna have a problem with my kids, because they're not getting raised by their father. What are you guys gonna do to make sure your officers do the right thing instead of doing the wrong thing and breaking up families instead of holding them together?
All right. Thank you for your comment. We do pride ourselves in the St. Paul Police Department of being professionals and responsive and trying to provide the best quality service. When members of our audience, members of our community, have an experience with a police officer that they feel is not up to the standards of the St. Paul Police Department. We ask that you reach out to a couple different avenues you have within the police department. Our internal affairs unit investigates policeman misconduct. They do it thoroughly. They do it well. We also have the Police Civilian Internal Affairs Review Commission, community members that look at these cases not within the police department. So we do have checks and balances. We try to maintain a positive police force, and we do have those avenues. Please call us if you feel that you've been received less than adequate police service. Thank you.
Hi.